I'm finally decided to return to reading some cozy stories. Nice, safe, cozy, comforting stories that you may have watched many moons ago. I have right now The Gingerbread Man. It's one I never actually read before, though. Like most of my generation, I've certainly seen it from Shrek. So, why don't we get ready? I'll get you a nice glass of milk, warm it up, and let's get to reading some cozy stories from me to you, sweetheart. And just in case, I did prepare a nice, tasty jasmine tea. Incredible. I love it. Hey, Teal. Welcome in, sweetheart. How are you doing tonight? I think I might go and change this to cozy bedtime stories. I think that'll look best, yeah. Stories. Perfect. Now, how are you, darlings? Take your time and relax. How are you doing? Ah, Teal, you're doing good. You're playing games with a friend, and it was nice. I'm glad to hear, sweetheart. So let's get back to making you cozy, okay? Again, this is the Gingerbread Man. One day, the cook went into the kitchen to make some gingerbread. She took some flour and water and treacle and ginger, I don't think I pronounced that right, and mixed them all well together. And she put in some water to make it thin, and put in some more flour to make it thick. Add a little salt and some spice, and then she rolled it out into a beautiful, smooth, dark yellow dough. Then she took the square tins and cut out some square cakes for the little boys. And with some round tins, she cut out some round cakes for the little girls. And then she took a nice round lump of dough for his body and a smaller lump for his head, which she pulled out a little for the neck. Two other lumps were stuck on beneath the legs and were pulled out into proper shape, with feet and toes all complete. And two still smaller pieces were made into arms with dear little hands and fingers. But the nicest work was done with the head, for the top was frizzled up into a pretty sugar hat. On the other side was a dear little ear, and in front, after the nose had been carefully molded, a beautiful mouth was made out of big raisin, and two bright little eyes with burnt almonds and caraway seeds. Exactly. Such fine detail in a gingerbread man, wouldn't you say? And hi, Trey, sweetheart. I hope you're doing well tonight. And also, everyone, I hope the audio is fine. Please do tell me if it is. Then the gingerbread man was finished, ready for baking, and a very large, jolly little man was made. In fact, he looked so sly that the cook was afraid he was plotting some mischief. And when the baker, or the batter, was ready for the oven, she put in the square cakes, and she put in the round cakes, and then she put in the little gingerbread man in the far back corner, where he couldn't get away in a hurry. Then she went up to sweep the parlor, and she swept and swept till the clock struck 12. Then she dropped her broom in a hurry and exclaimed, locks of gingerbread will all be baked into a cinder. She ran down into the kitchen, threw open the oven door. The square cakes were all done, nice, hard, and brown. The round cakes were all done, nice, hard, and brown. And the gingerbread was all done, too, nice, hard, and brown. And he was standing up in his corner with his little caraway seed eyes sparkling and his raisin mouth bubbling over with mischief. Well, he waited for the oven door to be opened. The instant the door was opened, with a hop, skip, and a jump, he went over to the square cakes and round cakes and took the cook's arm, and before she could say Jack Robinson, he was running across the kitchen floor. As fast as he went right over the square cake, as fast as his little legs would carry him, towards the back door, which was standing wide open, through which he could see the garden path. Run, run, fast as you can. You can't catch me, I'm the gingerbread man. And hi, Jonathan. How are you doing tonight? I hope you're nice, relaxed, and ready for a good cozy story, sweetie. I was originally planning a normal ASMR stream, but I thought this might be a little nicer. It's a nice little break. A little cute children's stories from many, many moons ago. Perhaps we do. Perhaps. As the old cook turned around as fast as she could, which wasn't very fast, for she was rather a heavy woman who had been quite taken by surprise, she saw lying right across the doorway, fast asleep in the sun, old Mouser, the cat. Mouser, Mouser, she cried, stop the gingerbread man. I went him for little Bobby. When the cook first called, Mouser thought it was only someone calling in her dreams, and simply rolled over lazily, and the cook called again. Mouser, Mouser, the old cat sprang up with a jump. But just as she turned round to ask the cook what was all the noise about, the little gingerbread man cleverly jumped under her tail, and in an instant was trotting down the garden walk. Mouser turned in a hurry and ran after, although she was still rather too sleepy to know what she was trying to catch. After the cat came the cook, lumbering along rather heavily, but also making pretty good speed. Now at the bottom of the walk, lying fast asleep in the sun against the warm stones of the garden wall, was Tosser, the dog. The cook called out, Tosser, Tosser, stop the gingerbread man. I want him for little Bobby. And when Tosser first heard her calling, he thought it was someone speaking in his dreams. And he only turned over on his side with another snore. Then the cook called again, Tosser, Tosser, stop him, stop him. Then the dog woke up in a good earnest and jumped up on his feet to see when it was he should stop. But just as the dog jumped, the little gingerbread man, who had been waiting for the chance, quietly slipped under his legs and climbed up on the top of a stone wall, so that Tosser saw nothing but the cat running towards him down the walk, and behind the cat the cook, now quite out of breath, run, run, as fast as you can. You can't catch me, I'm the gingerbread man. He thought at once that the cat must have stolen something, and that was a cook who wanted him to stop. Oh, hi, Fiend. How are you doing, sweetie? I decided to read children's stories for the night. More accurately, bedtime stories. Because they sound real cozy and sweet, don't they? And I think you all would enjoy him. But how are you doing, sweetheart? And the same goes for you, Jonathan. How are you doing? Oh, you're You're doing good. I'm doing all right. I just had a very delicious coffee, and now I have a jasmine tea to the right. And earlier, I went out and had a delicious tea and coffee. Or cookie and coffee. I think I have a picture of it in the Discord, so if you want, I can just go and pin that real quick. Give me just a moment, sweeties, and then we'll get right back to reading the story. And hi, Crunchy, how are you doing? These are old-timey ones, but Fiend, if you'd like me to read newer ones that are safe for stream, you can just whisper me the links, and I'll go read them, sweetheart. And hi, Crunchy, how are you doing tonight? You like the old ones. I'm perfect. Let me go add a link to the Discord here. Though, do please be aware that I'd like the Discord to be say-so. So if you do join, please do be say-so, as it makes me happy. There we go. Hopefully you can enjoy that. Now, back to the other one. Oh, you took a university class in fairy tales. Oh, you're doing good. I'm actually doing quite good today, Huntsman. I didn't really work too much, which saddened me because the more I work, the more money I get, and that means I can actually eat something. But I'm okay, as I had a delicious donut too. I was all spirally and covered with cinnamon and apple spice. And I, of course, recommend it greatly. And Twisted Puppy, would you like to relax here in my lap? I have a nice, warm pillow I can wrap you in. And recently I got a blanket that's crocheted and is made of rainbows. It's real cute. Thank you, Crunchy. I just have an issue with spending money on myself if it doesn't make money. Which isn't really the healthiest thing, but it's how I am. But thank you, sweetheart. Now let me figure out where I was last reading. Right there. Chocolate eclairs are the best with cream filling. Oh, Twisted. I just give it to you, sweetheart. You're perfectly magical as you are, aren't you? I'm sure you can just donate some rainbows. Oh, sweet Twisted. Relax to me as I read you a story. Now, if there was anything that Tosser liked, it was going after the cat. No, Queen. I'm just calling you amazing. Because that's truly what you are. It was going after the cat, and he jumped up the walk so fiercely that the poor cat did not have time to stop herself or to get out of his way, and they came together with a great fizzing and barking and meowing and howling and scratching. Oh, donuts with cream. I prefer my donuts with jelly, sweetie. Cream upsets my stomach. And if anyone wants, I'll take a picture of the crocheted rainbow blanket after I stream. It's real cute, by the way. Howling and scratching and biting, as if a couple of Kaffron wheels had gone off in the wrong way and had gotten mixed up with one another. But the old cook had been running so hard that she was not able to stop herself any better than the cat had done. And she fell right on top of the mixed-up dog and cat, so that all three rolled over on the walk in a heap together. And the cat scratched up whichever came nearest, whether it was a piece of the dog or the cook, and the dog bit at whatever came nearest. Whether it was a piece of the cat or the cook, so that the poor cook was badly pummeled on both sides. Meanwhile, the gingerbread man had climbed up the garden wall and stood on top of his hands and his pockets, looking at the scrimmage and laughing till the tears ran down his little caraway seed eyes, and his raisin mouth was bubbling over with fun. Run, run, as fast as you can. You can't catch me. I'm the gingerbread man. It's okay, Felix. I can just have a lactase pill before I eat it to help with it. And welcome in, Tori, sweetheart. I hope you're doing well and cozy. And you have a blankie that your mother crocheted for you. If you could, Huntsman, could you send me a picture of that? Sounds absolutely darling. And hi, Tori. How are you tonight, sweetie? I hope you sipped enough water and that you've been healthy. I want the best for you, after all. I'll go sip some more water. Take your time, sweet Crunchy. Take your time. Oh, you're doing all right. I'm happy to hear you, sweetheart. After a little while, the cat managed to pull herself out from under the cook and the dog, and a very cast down and crumpled up looking cat she was. She had had enough of hunting gingerbread men, and she crept back to the kitchen to repair damages. The dog, who was very cross because his face had been badly scratched, let go of the cook, and at last, catching sight of the gingerbread man, made a bolt for the garden wall. The cook picked herself up, and although her face was badly scratched and her dress was torn, she was determined to see the end of the chase. She followed after the dog, though this time more slowly. When the gingerbread man saw the dog coming, he jumped down on the farther side of the wall and began running across the field. Now in the middle of the field was a tree, and at the foot of the tree was lying Jocko the monkey. He wasn't asleep, monkeys never are, and when he saw the little man running across the field and heard the cook calling, "Jocko, Jocko, stop the gingerbread man," he gave at once in one big jump, but he jumped so fast and so far that he went right over the gingerbread man. And as luck would have it, he came down on the back of Towser the dog, who had just scrambled over the wall, and whom he had not before noticed. Towser was naturally taken by surprise, and he had turned his head around and probably bit off the end of the monkey's tail, and Jocko quickly jumped off again, chattering his indignation. Meanwhile, the gingerbread man had got to the bottom of the tree and was saying to himself, "Now I know the dog can climb a tree, and I don't believe the old cook can climb a tree. But as for the monkey, I'm not sure. I never seen a monkey before, but I am going up. Thank you. You have an electrolyte imbalance? I understand that. When I sweat quite a lot, I get a little bit sick and have to chug a Gatorade or two. And thank you, sweet Crunchy, for the picture. I'll go quickly look at it." Ah, it's adorable. Truly adorable, sweetie. And you want a new one? That's understandable. I will send a photo of mine, of course, in a little bit, but oddly, there's no orange in it. Only red, yellow, green, blue, purple. So that's a little curious. So he pulled himself up, hand over hand, until he had gone up to the topmost branch. Okay, I'll say that one seemed twisted after a few more paragraphs. "Climb, climb, as fast as you can. You can't catch me, I'm the gingerbread man." But the monkey had jumped up, with one spring onto the lowest branch, in an instant he was also at the top of the tree. The gingerbread man had crawled out of the topmost end of the branch and hung on by only one hand, but the monkey swung himself under the branch, and stretching out his long arm, he pulled the gingerbread man in, and then held him up and looked at him so hungrily that a little raisin mouth began to pucker down at the corners, and the caraway seed's eyes were filled with tears. And what do you think happened? Why, little Bobby himself came running up. He had been taking his noonday nap down or upstairs. And in his dreams, it seemed as if he had kept hearing people call little Bobby, until finally he jumped up with a start and was so sure that someone was calling him that he ran downstairs without even waiting to put on shoes. As he came down, he could see through the window in the field beyond the garden cook, the dog, and the monkey, and he could even hear the barking of Towser and the chattering of Jocko. He scampered down the walk, and with his little bare feet powered against the warm gravel, climbed over the wall and in a few seconds under the tree, just as Jocko was holding up the poor little gingerbread man. "Drop it, Jocko," cried Bobby, and drop it Jocko did, for he'd always had to mind Bobby. He dropped it so straight that the gingerbread man fell right into Bobby's unlifted pinafore. Then Bobby held him up and looked at him, and the little raisin mouth puckered down lower than ever, and the tears ran out right to the caraway seed eyes. But Bobby was too hungry to mind gingerbread tears. He gave one big bite, swallowed down both legs and a piece of the body. "Oh," said the gingerbread man, "I'm one third gone." Bobby gave a second bite and swallowed the rest of the body and the arms. "Oh," said the gingerbread man, "I'm two thirds gone." So you can't see this right now, but the depiction of the child is pretty ugly. Bobby gave a third bite and gulped down the head. "Oh," said the gingerbread man, "I'm all gone." Oh, whoa. And that is the end of the story. The Gingerbread Man. My first time ever reading it. Oh, I know, it has so succubae. Welcome in, sweetheart. How are you tonight? Welcome in, man of massive bladder. Welcome in, Arky. Hi, custom sweetie. And welcome in, did I ruin it? How are you tonight? Let me go give sweet succubae a shout out, as she's truly amazing and deserves all the love and affection. There we go. A shout out to wonderful succubae. Hi, bae. How are you tonight? Are you finally ready to go to sleep? Or are you going to watch a movie in the server tonight? Whatever it is you're doing, I do always wish you the best, sweetie, because I know you truly deserve it. But, bae, if you need to go to the bathroom, sip some delicious water, stare at Scrim as it sleeps, do. Take your time. Stream is going rather well. I'm enjoying it, and this is actually something I used to do more often, where I read cozy nighttime children's stories, if you will, and I enjoy it greatly. Let me go sip some tea now. And hi, Magma. How are you tonight, sweetie? But sweet bae, take your time, rest, relax. I'm probably going to lower the fireplace and just hope it's well enough. And, Bae, if you could, sweetie, would you like to select the next story that I'm going to read? I want to make it special and give you the choice of reading something cozy and wonderful. Just to make sure that you're happy. Let's see. Aesop's Fables. That might be a bit too long. The Princess and the Pea. Oh. Well, those picks are just something completely say-so, and definitely not my own thigh picks. And the QR code definitely doesn't go somewhere special. Sure. So let me see what I have here. The Little Mermaid, Grimm's Fairy Tales, Mother Goose Rhymes, The Princess and the Pea, Rapunzel, Five Little Pigs, The Little Old Woman Who Lived in a Shoe, Ooh, The Snow Queen, Father Frost. A lot of these stories are. Yeah, I had to scroll down because I kind of read a lot of them. But if you want, I can also read you something like The Velveteen Rabbit or Jack and Beanstalk, Little Red Riding Hood, Three Little Peas, The Tale of Peter Rabbit, The Elves and the Shoemaker, Winnie the Pooh, My Father's Dragon might be a bit long. Snow White, St. George and the Dragon, Cinderella, Peter Rabbit. Perfect then, Bae. I'll go read that. And there we go. By the way, I have to do some trigger words for Sweet Twisted. So get ready for this. Jaundiced juveniles. Jaundiced juveniles. Jaundiced juveniles. There's truly a rambunctious group of rambunctious juveniles here. And thank you for the follow, Zao. How are you tonight, sweetheart? Have you sipped enough water? Have you been healthy? I certainly hope you've been. Now, The Tale of Peter Rabbit by Beatrix Potter. Wow, from 1902. This one should be absolutely darling, shouldn't it? Once upon a time, there were four little rabbits. Let me read this small nerd moment. Make you can recommend putting a white border on the left edge of a QR code as well. Makes it easier for devices to scan it. Oh, certainly, sweetie. I just had to move it to cover up the VTube Studio little watermark. That's also why I have 2 5 picks there, but ignore the burp. Incredibly based man with massive bladder. Once upon a time, there were four little rabbits. Their names were Flopsy, Mopsy, Cottontail, and Peter. They lived with their mother on a sandbank underneath the root of a very big fir tree. Now, my dear, said Miss or Old Miss Rabbit one morning, you may go in the fields or down the lane, but don't go into Mr. McGregor's garden. Your father had an accident there, and he was put into a pie by Mrs. McGregor. Now run along and don't get into mischief. I'm going out. Then old Miss Rabbit took a basket and her umbrella to the baker's. She bought a loaf of brown bread and 5 currant buns. Flopsy, Mopsy, and Cottontail, who were a good little buns, or bunnies, went down the lane to gather blackberries. But Peter, who was very naughty, ran straight away to Mr. McGregor's garden and squeezed under the gate. First he ate some lettuces and some French beans. Then he ate some radishes, and then, feeling rather sick, he went to look for some parsley. But around the end of a cucumber frame, whom should he meet but Mr. McGregor? Oh, hi, Orpheus. I recently looked at your profile and saw that you had Mudahar as your profile pic. He was very darling. And hi, Lizzie. How are you doing tonight? I hope you can have a great, cozy time. I'm going to be reading Peter Rabbit, because that's what Sweet Succubae requested. Mr. McGregor, who was on his hands and knees planting some young cabbages, or planting out some young cabbages, but he had jumped up and ran after Peter, waving a rake and calling out, "Stop thief!" Peter was most dreadfully frightened. He rushed all over the garden, for he had forgotten the way back to the gate. He had lost one of his shoes among the cabbages, and the other shoe amongst the potatoes. After losing them, he ran out on 4 legs, and faster, so that he might have gotten away altogether had he not unfortunately ran into a gooseberry net and got caught by the large buttons on his jacket. It was a blue jacket with brass buttons, quite new. Oh, you're good so far. I'm happy to hear, sweet Lizzie. And please, feel free to a cozy redeem, take a sip, rest as I read you some good sweet stories. There, Peter gave himself up for lost, and shed big tears, but his sobs were overheard by some friendly sparrows, who flew to him in great excitement, and implored him to exert himself. Mr. McGregor came up with a sieve, which he intended to pop upon the top of Peter, but Peter wriggled out just in time, leaving his jacket behind him, and rushed into the tool shed and jumped into a can. It would have made a beautiful thing to hide in, if he had not had so much water in it. Mr. McGregor was quite sure that Peter was somewhere in the tool shed, perhaps hidden underneath a flower pot. He began to turn them over carefully, looking under each. Presently, Peter sneezed. "Carrie, teach you." Mr. McGregor was after him in no time, and tried to put his foot upon Peter, who jumped out of a window, upsetting 3 plants. The window was too small for Mr. McGregor, and he was tired of running after Peter. He went back to his work. Peter sat down to rest. He was out of breath and trembling of fright. And he had not the least idea which way to go. He was also very damp from sitting in that can. My. After a time, he began to wander about, going lippity-lippity, not very fast, looking all around. He found a door in the wall, but it was locked. There was no room for a fat little rabbit to squeeze underneath. An old mouse was running in and out over the stone doorstep. carrying peas and beans for her family in the wood. Peter asked her the way to get out of the gate, but she had a large pea in her mouth and she could not answer. She only shook her head at him. Peter began to cry. And out over the stone doorstep, carrying peas. Nope, I read that, sorry. Then he tried to find his way straight across the garden, but he soon became more and more puzzled. Presently, he came to a pond where Mr. McGregor filled his water cans. A white cat was staring at some goldfish. She sat very, very still, but now and then the tip of her tail twitched, as if it were alive. Peter thought it was best to go away without speaking to her. He had heard about cats from his cousin, little Benjamin Bunny. He went back towards the tool shed, but suddenly, quite close to him, he heard the noise of a hoe. Scritch. Oh, I can actually do that. Scritch. Scratch. Scratch. Peter scuttled underneath the bushes, but presently, as nothing happened, he came out and climbed upon a wheelbarrow and peeped over. The first thing he saw was Mr. McGregor hoeing onions. His back was turned towards Peter, and beyond him was the gate. Peter got down very quietly off the wheelbarrow and started running as fast as he could go along a straight walk behind some blackcurrant bushes. Mr. McGregor caught sight of him at the corner, but Peter did not care. He slipped underneath the gate and is safe at last in the wood outside the garden. Mr. McGregor hung up the little jacket and his shoes for a scarecrow to frighten the blackbirds. Peter never stopped running or looked behind him till he got home to the big fir tree. He was so tired that he flopped down upon the nice soft sand on the floor of the rabbit hole and shut his eyes. His mother was busy cooking. She wondered what he had done with his clothes. It was his second little jacket and pair of shoes that Peter had lost in a fortnight. I am sorry to say that Peter was not very well during the evening. His mother had put him to bed and made some chamomile tea, and she gave a dose of it to Peter. One tablespoonful to be taken at bedtime, but Flopsy, Mopsy, and Cottontail had bread and milk and blackberries for supper. Oh my, oh my. The end. I hope you enjoyed that, Succubae. It was a good tale, wasn't it? Oh, what to read next? Winnie the Pooh, perhaps. Or the Three Little Pigs. No problem, sweetie. As long as it makes you happy, I'm perfectly content to read it. Now, I don't have you on Discord to my recollection, but what would you like me to read to you next? The Three Little Pigs, Little Red Riding Hood, The Velveteen Rabbit, Jack and the Beanstalk, Winnie the Pooh, The Tortoise and the Hare, Cinderella, Snow White, The Ugly Duckling, Thumbelina, The Little Thief in the Pantry, Alice in Wonderland, Five Little Pigs. I didn't actually know of that just before I saw it. Uh-oh. But what would you like next, sweet bae? I hope you're taking care of yourself too. Sipping that delicious water. Being healthy. That made me go into your stream and or your channel and do a bunch of wonderful hydration redeems. I don't think I actually can, but Let's act like I can. And to all the people who came from Baystream, if you would like to listen to me more, feel free to drop a follow. It's perfectly okay. In the meantime, though, I'll sip some water, or in this case, tea. No, I don't have to feel bad picking Genbe. Good boy. Good. Good boy. Good boy. Good. Good. Do a quick poll. Rapunzel, let down your hair. Then there's the Little Mermaid. Another one. Ooh. Three little pigs. And I think that'll be okay. There we go. And we'll make it a 3 minute one. One. And yes, I'll make it to where you can rig it. But in the meantime, sweeties, I will actually do some more ASMR type things. So, why don't you just close those beautiful eyes? I know they're heavy after a long, long day. Twisted. It's actually becoming more common for people to use a single computer, as the old adage of using dual computers for streaming has become a little outdated with the newer streaming codecs and NVENC coding. From NVIDIA, but if you truly wish to, just get something of enough cores on the stream compression computer so that you can do the stream encoding on CPU, and for gaming, just get something of a good card. You should be fine. And in the meantime, such a good girl. Good, good girl. Oh, you're in debt. Hey. Welcome to the modern era. Oh, thank you, Maki Zendo. I do take everything as a nice cozy compliment. And indeed, indeed, Sakibe. Indeed, sweetheart. Oh, interesting. podcasting. I'm back to 15 subs again. It's always so weird, Twitch. But anyway, I do hope you can easily resolve yourself. Was it? Would the good girl like herself a free redeem? Oh my. Thank you, Crunchy. I gotta delete that one message because it's probably a bit too woo-woo. But thank you, Crunchy, sweetheart, for the sub. It does mean quite a lot, and thank you, darling. And, Bae, feel free to ask for a free redeem. Not only do you deserve one for subbing, but you deserve one for the raid and being amazing. And same goes to you, Crunchy. If you'd like a redeem, just ask. In the meantime, it was three little pigs which had one. Perfect. Now, I'm gonna click this, and perfect. Geek out as high as you can get. Kisses. Okay, sweet bae. I'm gonna do that. Let me move back my cute sweater. It's real cute, would recommend. After this one, I think I'll read Velveteen Rabbit for you, sweet bae. That one seems happy. Once upon a time, there was an old mother pig who had three little pigs and not enough food to feed them. So when they were old enough, she sent them out to live in the world to seek their fortunes. First little pig was very lazy. He didn't want to work at all, so he built his house out of straw. The second pig worked a little harder, but he was somewhat lazy too, so he built his house out of sticks. Oh my, twisted. Then they sang and danced and played together for the rest of the day. The third little pig worked hard all day and built his house with bricks. It was a sturdy house complete with a fine fireplace and chimney, and it looked like it could withstand the strongest winds. The next day, thank you, sweet pickle. May you too have a lovely, darling day. I know. I used to have my YouTube recommendations like that too. The next day, a wolf happened to pass by the lane where the three pigs lived, and he saw the straw house, and he smelled the pig inside. He thought the pig would make a mighty fine meal, and his mouth began to water. So he knocked on the door and said, Answered back.
No, no, not by the halves of my chinny chin chin.
Then the wolf showed his teeth and said, then I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house down. So he huffed and he puffed and he blew the house down. The wolf opened his jaws very wide and bit down as hard as he could, but the first little pig escaped and ran away to hide with the second pig. The wolf continued down the lane, and he passed by the second house made of sticks, and he saw the house. He smelled the pigs inside, and his mouth began to water as he thought about the fine dinner they would make. So he knocked on the door and said, little pigs, let me in, let me in. But the little pigs saw the wolf's pointy ears through the keyhole, so they answered back,
no, 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 not by the hairs of our chinny chin chin.
So the wolf showed his teeth and said, I'll huff, and I'll puff, and I'll blow your house down. And may you have a good sweet sleep, darling twisted. May you dream of cute, soft, cozy things, and awake to a new, fresh tomorrow. Have a good time now, sweetie. So he huffed and he puffed and he blew the house down. The wolf was greedy and he tried to catch both pigs at once, but he was too greedy. That's okay, sweet pig. I know you had a long day and you certainly deserve your sleep, sweetheart. Have a kiss for whenever you do. And may you too sleep well and sleep good. Okay, sweetheart. The wolf was too greedy, and he tried to catch both pigs at once. But he was too greedy and got neither. His big jaws clamped down on nothing but air, and the two little pigs scrambled away as fast as their little hooves could carry them. The wolf chased them down the lane, and he almost got them. But they made it to the brick house, then slammed the door closed before the wolf could catch them. The three little pigs were very frightened, and they knew the wolf wanted to eat them, and that was very, very true. The wolf hadn't eaten all day, and he had worked up a large appetite chasing the pigs around, and now he could smell all three of them inside. And he knew that the three little pigs would make a lovely feast. So the wolf knocked on the door and said, little pigs, let me in. But the little pigs saw the wolf's narrow eyes for the keyhole. So they answered back,
no, 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 not by the hairs of our chinny chin chin.
So the wolf showed his teeth and said, then I'll huff, and I'll puff, and I'll blow your house down.
Oh,
hi, Veggie Burrito. How are you doing tonight, sweetheart? Are you doing well? Exercised, or just had a nice, cozy, lazy day. And thank you for a follow, sweetheart. Because because you decide to follow the sweet little me, you can get yourself a free redeem. Oh, you're chillin'. Perfect. Don't tell anyone, but I was supposed to work a little bit more today. I didn't. I kinda just relaxed and enjoyed it, you know. Well, he huffed and he puffed, he huffed and he puffed, and he huffed, huffed, and he puffed, puffed, but he could not blow the house down. At last, he was so out of breath that he couldn't huff, and he couldn't puff anymore, so he stopped to rest and thought a bit. Indeed, very reliable, sweet veggie. But this was too much. The wolf danced about with rage and swore he would come down the chimney and eat up the little pig for his supper. But while he was climbing on the roof, the little pig made up a blazing fire and put on a big pot full of water to boil. Then, just as the wolf was coming down the chimney, the little piggy pulled off the lid, and plop, in fell in the wolf into the scalding water. So the little piggy put up on the cover again, and boiled the wolf up, and the three little pigs ate him for supper. Hi, Roxy, sweetheart. How are you doing tonight? Have you slept well? Have you had a good, cozy day? I hope you have, sweetheart. Perfect. You want some head pat, sweet veggie? Okay. I'll give you some in just a little moment, sweetheart. Oh, thank you for joining, sweetie. I hope you have a good, cozy time in the server. Now, let me go do this, and in the meantime, relax. I'll also do some brushing, too. But relax, sweetie. You're safe here. Listen to me as I serenade you to sleep, and you just rest. Oh, you've had a good day. I'm glad to hear it, sweetheart, and I hope I can make it even better and even more cozy here tonight. In the meantime, Roxy, have a kiss. Some front brushing and get to it. Stealing my cookies, aren't you, Tori? I thought we only had one cookie thief. But it appears that we now have two. That's okay. still love and accept you regardless, darling. Now, let me get to reading The Velveteen Rabbit by Marjorie Williams. I do a little yawn. There once was, and I love you too, sweet Benji. I hope those head pads were nice and cozy. Unfortunately, I don't have my other microphone that I can actually put on my lap, but many cozy lap head pads to you too. And I'll go turn up the fireplace, because it's very possible it's too quiet right now. There. There once was a Velveteen Rabbit. And in the beginning, he was really splendid. He was fat and bunchy, as a rabbit should be. His coat was spotted brown and white. He had real thread whiskers, and his ears were lined with pink sateen. On Christmas morning, when he sat wedged on top of the boy's stocking, with a sprig of holly between his paws, the effect was charming. There were other things in the stockings, nuts, oranges, and a toy engine, and chocolate almonds, and a clockwork mouse. But the rabbit was the best of all. For at least 2 hours, the boy loved him, and then aunts and uncles came to dinner, and there was a great rustling of tissue paper and unwrapping of parcels. And in the excitement of looking for all the new presents, the Velveteen Rabbit was forgotten. For a long time, he lived in a toy cupboard or on the nursery floor, and no one thought very much about him. He was naturally shy, and being only made of velveteen, some of the more expensive toys quite snubbed him. The mechanical toys were very superior, and he looked down upon everyone else. Hi, Winter Sweetheart. Welcome in. I hope you've been having a good time. And I'll do nail tappies on the wooden box in just a moment, sweetie. I want to finish this one paragraph. They were very full of modern ideas and pretended they're real. The model boat, who had been lived for 2 seasons and lost most of his paint, caught the tone from them and never missed an opportunity of referring to his rigging in technical terms. The rabbit could not claim to be a model of anything, for he didn't know that real rabbits existed. He thought they were all stuffed with sawdust, like himself. And he understood that sawdust was quite out of date and should never be mentioned in modern circles. Even Timothy, the jointed wooden lion, who was made by the disabled soldiers, wouldn't have broader views, put on airs, and pretended that he was connected with government. Between all them all, the poor rabbit was made to feel himself very insignificant and commonplace. The only person who was kind to him at all was the skin horse. And thank you, Winter. I'll take a sip, sweetheart. Now, I'll grab the little box and do the tappies. But Winter, sweetheart, how are you doing? Trying to find a better spot. No problem, Veggie. Just tired as usual. That's okay, sweet Winter. You can relax here. You're welcomed and accepted as you are. And by the way, Veggie, would you like me to do the tappies and read to you simultaneously? Or would you like me to just do tappies for a little longer? And hi, welcome in, Gab, sweetheart. I hope you're doing well and relaxing, perfectly divine. Both seems nice. Okay, Veggie. Will do. Of course. I'm here to give you the most cozy experience you need. You're doing well so far, Gabs. Glad to hear it, darling. I had delicious cookie and the spiral donut thing, and it made me quite happy. Then I had a coffee, and yeah, it was quite fun. Would recommend, sweetheart. Skinned horse had lived longer in the nursery than any of the others. He was so old that his brown coat was bald in patches and showed the seams underneath. Most of his hairs on his tail had been pulled out to string bead necklaces. He was wise, for he had seen a long succession of mechanical toys arrive to boast and swagger, and by the by, break their mainsprings and pass away. And he knew that they were only toys, they would never turn into anything else. For nursery magic is very strange and wonderful, and only those playthings that were old and wise and experienced, like the skin horse, understood all about it. "What is real?" asked the rabbit one day. They were laying side by side near the nursery fender before Nana came to tidy the room. "Does it mean having things that buzz inside you and stick out the handle?" "Real isn't how you are made," said the skinned horse. "It's a thing that happens to you when a child loves you for a long, long time, not just to play with, but really loves you. Then you become real." "Does it hurt?" asked the rabbit. That's an interesting question. "Sometimes," said the skinned horse, for he was always truthful. "When you are real, you don't mind being hurt. Does it all happen at once, like being wound up?" he asked, "or bit by bit?" "It doesn't happen all at once," said the skinned horse. "You become. It takes a long time. That's why it doesn't often happen with to people who break easily, or sharp edges, or who have to be carefully kept. Generally, by the time you're real, most of your hair that you have been loved off, your eyes drop out. You get loose in the joints and very shabby. But these things don't matter at all, because once you are real, you can't be ugly, except to people who don't understand." "I suppose you are real?" asked the rabbit. And then he wished he had not said that, for he felt the skin horse might be sensitive, but the skin horse only smiled. "The boy's uncle made me real. That was a great many years ago. But once you're real, you can't become unreal again. It lasts for always." The rabbit sighed. He thought about it for a long time, for his magic called real happened to him. He longed to become real, to know what it felt like. And yet the idea of growing shabby and losing his eyes and whiskers was rather sad. He wished that he could become it without these uncomfortable things happening to him. There was a person called Nana who ruled the nursery. Sometimes she took no notice of the playthings lying about, and sometimes, for no reason whatever, she went swooping about like a great wind and hustled them all into cupboards. She called this tidying up. and the playthings all hated it, especially the tin ones. The rabbit didn't mind it so much, for whenever he was thrown, he came down soft. One evening, when the boy was going to bed, he couldn't find a china dog that always slept with him. Nana was in a hurry, and it was too much trouble to hunt for china dogs at bedtime. So she simply looked about her, and seeing that the toy cupboard door stood open, she made a swoop. "Here," she said, "take your old bunny. He'll do to sleep with you." And she dragged the rabbit out by one ear and put him into the boy's arms. That night, and for many nights after, the Velveteen Rabbit slept in the boy's bed. At first he found it rather uncomfortable, for the boy hugged him very tight, and sometimes he rolled over on him, and sometimes he pushed him so far under the pillow that the rabbit could scarcely breathe. And he missed, too, those long moonlight hours in the nursery, when all the house was silent, and his talks with the skinned horse. But very soon he grew to like it, for the boy used to talk to him, and made nice tunnels for him under the bedclothes. Oh, burp. Ah. He said were like the burrows that real rabbits lived in, and they had splendid games together in whispers when Nana had gone away to her supper and left the nightlight burning on the mantelpiece. And when the boy dropped off to sleep, the rabbit would snuggle down close under his warm chin and dream, with the boy's hands clasped close round him all night long. And so time went on, and the little rabbit was very happy. So happy that he never noticed how his beautiful velveteen fur was getting shabbier and shabbier, and his tail was coming unsewn, and all the pink rubbed off his nose where the boy had kissed him. Spring came, and they had long days. Oh, next page. In the garden, for wherever the boy went with the rabbit, the rabbit went too. He had rides in the wheelbarrow, and picnics in the grass, and a lovely fairy hut built for him under the raspberry canes, behind the flower border. And once, when the boy was called away suddenly to go out for tea, the rabbit was left out on the lawn until long after dusk, and Nana had come and looked for him with the candle, because the boy couldn't go to sleep unless he was there. He was wet through the dew, and quite earthy from living into the burrows the boy had made for him in the flower bed, and Nana grumbled as she rubbed him off of the corner of her apron. "You must have your old bunny," she said. "Fancy all that fuss for a toy." The boy sat up in bed and stretched out his arms. "Give me my bunny." "You mustn't say that. He isn't a toy. He's real." When the little rabbit heard that, he was happy, for he knew that the skinned horse had said was true at last. The nursery magic had happened to him, and he was a toy no longer. He was a real boy. The boy himself had said it. Let me go itch my nose. That night, he was almost too happy to sleep, and so much love stirred in his little sawdust heart that it almost burst, and into his boot button eyes had long ago lost their polish, and there came a look of wisdom and beauty, so that even Nana noticed it next morning when she picked him up and said, "I declare that if old Bunny hasn't got quite a knowing expression. That was a wonderful summer. Near the house where they had lived was a wood, and in the long June evenings, the boy liked to go there after tea to play. He took the velveteen rabbit with him, and before he wandered off to pick flowers or play at brigands amongst the trees, he had always made the rabbit a little nest somewhere among the bracken, where he would be quite cozy, for he was quite kind-hearted little boy, and he liked Bunny to be comfortable. One evening, while the rabbit was lying there alone, watching the ants that ran to and fro between his velvet paws in the grass, he saw two strange beings creep out of the tall bracken near him. They were rabbits like himself, but quite furry and brand new. They must have been very well made, for their seams didn't show at all, and they changed shape in a queer way as they moved. One minute they were long and thin, and next minute fat and bunchy. Instead of always staying the same like he did, their feet padded softly on the ground, and they crept quiet close to him, twitching their noses while the rabbit stared hard to see which side the clockwork struck out. And for he knew that people who jump gently or generally have something to wind them up. But he couldn't see it. They're evidently a new kind of rabbit altogether. They stared at him, the little rabbit stared back, and all the time their noses twitched. "Why don't you get up and play with us?" asked one of them. "I don't feel like it," said the rabbit, for he didn't want to explain they had no clockwork. "Ho," said the rabbit, or furry rabbit, "it is easy as anything." He gave a big hop sideways and stood on his hind legs. "I don't believe you can," he said. "I can," said the little rabbit. "I can jump higher than anything," he meant when the boy threw him, but of course he didn't want to say so. "Can you hop on your hind legs?" asked the furry rabbit. That was a dreadful question, for the velveteen rabbit had no hind legs at all, and the back of him was made all in one piece, like a pincushion. He sat still in the bracken and hoped that the other rabbits wouldn't notice. "I don't want to," he said again, "but the wild rabbits have sharp eyes," and this one stretched out his neck and looked. "He hasn't got any hind legs," he cried out. "Fancy a rabbit without any hind legs," and he began to laugh. "I cried," said the little rabbit. "I have got hind legs. I am sitting on them. Then stretch them out and show me, like this," said the wild rabbit, and he began to whirl round and dance, till the little rabbit got quite dizzy. "I don't like dancing," he said. "I'd rather sit still," but all the while he was longing to dance, for a funny new ticky feeling ran through him, and he felt that he'd give anything in the world to be able to jump about like these little rabbits did. The strange rabbit stopped dancing and came quite close. He came so close this time that his long whiskers brushed the velveteen rabbit's ears. And then he wrinkled his nose suddenly, flattened his ears, and jumped backwards. "He doesn't smell right. He isn't a rabbit at all. He isn't real." "I am real," said the little rabbit. "I am real. The boy said so," and he nearly began to cry. Just then there was a sound of footsteps. The boy ran past them, and stamp of feet and flash of white tails was two. The two strange rabbits disappeared. "Come back and play with me," called the little rabbit. "Oh, do come back. I know I am real." But there was no answer. for only the little ants ran to and fro, and the bracken swayed gently where the two strangers had passed. The velveteen rabbit was all alone. Oh dear, he thought. Why did they run away like that? Why couldn't they stop and talk to me? For a long while he lay very still, watching the bracken, hoping they would come back, but they never returned. Presently the sun sank lower, and the two little white moths fluttered about, and a boy came out and carried him home. Weeks passed, and the little rabbit grew very old and shabby. But the boy loved him just as much. He loved him so hard that all of his whiskers off, the pink lining of his ears turned gray, and his brown spots faded. He even began to lose his shape, and he scarcely looked like a rabbit anymore. I am, sweet Nancy. I do love reading to you all, making it cozy. Right now it's Peter Rabbit, before I read The Three Little Pigs, and before that, I don't recall. He began to lose his shape, and he scarcely looked like a rabbit anymore, except to the boy. To him, he was always beautiful, and that was all the little rabbit cared about. He didn't mind how he looked to other people, because the nursery magic had made him real. And when you're real, shabbiness doesn't matter. Then one day, the boy was ill. Now, how are you tonight, Nancy, sweetheart? And yes, welcome in, of course. And, Gabs, do remember to sip some water. Same to you, Nancy. And same to all the lovely listeners, too. His face grew very flushed, and he talked in his sleep, and the little body was so hot that it burned the rabbit when he held him close. Strange people came and went into the nursery, and a light burned all night, and through it all, the little velveteen rabbit lay there, hidden from sight, under the bedclothes, and he never stirred, for he was afraid that if they found him, someone might take him away, and he knew that the boy needed him. It was a very long, weary time, for the boy was too ill to play, and a little rabbit found it rather dull with nothing to do all day long. Ah, I'm glad you're here too, sweet Nancy. Now please relax and drink some delicious water. And if you want, tell me how your day's been. Feel free to do so. If not, stay amazing because we still love and accept you. The little rabbit found it rather dull with nothing to do all day long, but he snuggled down patiently and looked forward to all the time when the boy would be well again, when they would go out in the garden amongst the flowers and the butterflies, and play splendid games in the raspberry thicket like they used to. All sorts of delightful things he planned. And while the boy lay half asleep, he crept up close to the pillow and whispered them in his ear. And presently the fever turned and the boy got better. He was able to sit up in bed and look at picture books while a little rabbit cuddled close at his side. And one day, they let him get up and dress. It was a bright, sunny morning. The windows stood wide open. The windows stood wide open. They carried the boy out to the balcony, wrapped in a shawl, and the little rabbit lay tangled up amongst the bedclothes. Thinking the boy was going to the seaside tomorrow, everything was arranged, and now it only remained to carry out the doctor's orders. They talked about it all, while the little rabbit lay under the bedclothes, with just his head peeping out and listening and listened. The room was to be disinfected. All the books and toys that the boy had played with in bed must be burnt. Hurrah, thought the little rabbit. Tomorrow we shall go to the seaside. For the boy had often talked to the seaside. He wanted very much to see the big waves coming in, the tiny crabs, and the sandcastles. Just then, Nana caught sight of him. What about the old bunny? She asked. That, said the doctor. Why, it's a mass of scarlet fever germs. Burn it at once. Nonsense. Get him a new one. He mustn't have that one anymore. And so the little rabbit was put into a sack with the old picture books and a lot of rubbish, and carried out to the end of the garden behind the fowl house. It was a fine place to make a bonfire, only the gardener was too busy just then to attend to it. He had potatoes to dig and green peas to gather. But next morning he promised to come quite early and burn the whole lot. That night the boy slept in a different bedroom he had new bunny to sleep with. It was a splendid bunny, all white plush, with real glass eyes. But the boy was too excited to care much about that, for tomorrow he was going to the seaside. And that in itself was such a wonderful thing that he could think of nothing else. My, oh my. This is becoming rather sad. And while the boy was asleep, dreaming of the seaside, the little rabbit lay among the old picture books in the corner behind the fowl house, and he felt very lonely. The sack had been left untied, and so by wriggling a bit, he was able to get his head through the opening and look out. He was shivering a little, for he had always been used to sleeping in a proper bed, and by this time his coat had worn so thin and threadbare from hugging that it was no longer any protection near or to him. Nearby, he could see the thicket of raspberry canes growing tall and close like a tropical jungle, in whose shadow he had played with the boy on bygone mornings. He thought of those long sunlit hours in the garden, how happy they were, and a great sadness came over him. He seemed to see them all pass before him, each beautiful than the other. The fairy huts in the flower bed, the quiet evenings in the wood when he lay in the bracken, the little ants that ran over his paws, the wonderful day when he first knew he was real. He thought of the skinned horse, so wise and gentle, and all that he had told him of what use it was to be loved. The loose one's beauty became real as if it ended like this, and the terror, a real tear trickled down his little shabby velvet nose and fell to the ground. And then a strange thing happened, for where the tear had fallen, a flower grew out of the ground, a mysterious flower, not at all like that, or like any that grew in the garden. It had slender green leaves the color of emeralds, and the center of the leaves a blossom like a golden cup. It was so beautiful that the little rabbit forgot to cry and just lay there watching. And presently, the blossom opened, and out of it there stepped a fairy. She was quite the loveliest fairy in the whole world. Her dress was of pearl and dewdrops, and there were flowers around her neck and in her hair. Her face was like the most perfect flower of all, and she came close to the little rabbit and gathered him up in her arms and kissed him on his velvet nose that was all damp from crying. "Little rabbit," she said, "don't you know who I am?" The rabbit looked up at her, and it seemed to him that he had seen her face before, but he couldn't think where. "I am the nursery magic fairy," she said. "I take care of all the playthings that children have loved, and when they're old and worn out, and the children don't need them anymore, then I come and take them away with me and turn them into real." "Wasn't I real before?" asked the little rabbit. "You were real to the boy," the fairy said, "because he loved you. Now you shall be real to everyone." And she held the little rabbit close in her arms and flew with him into the wood. It was light now, for the moon had risen. All the forest was beautiful, and the fronds of the bracken shone like frosted silver. In the open glade, between the tree trunks, the wild rabbits danced with their shadows on the velvet grass. And when they saw the fairy, they stopped dancing and stood round in a ring to stare at her. "I brought you a new playfellow," the fairy said. "You must be very kind to him and teach him all that he needs to know in Rabbitland, for he is going to live with you forever and ever." She kissed the little rabbit again and put him down on the grass. "Run and play, little rabbit," she said. But the little rabbit sat quite still for a moment, never moved. For when he saw all the wild rabbits dancing around him, he suddenly remembered about his hind legs, and he didn't want them to see that they're all in one piece. He did not know that for the moment the fairy kissed him, that last time she had changed him altogether. "Ah, you want a good girl. Okay, sweetie. I'll read that just after I finish the story. Or not story, but another few paragraphs." And that he might have sat there a long time, too shy to move. If just then something hand tickled his nose, and before he thought about what he was doing, he lifted his hind toe to scratch it. And then he found he had actually had hind legs. Instead of dingy velveteen, he had brown fur, soft and shiny. His ears twitched by themselves. His whiskers were so long that they brushed the grass. He gave one leap, and the joy of using those hind legs was so great that he went springing about the turf on them, jumping sideways and whirling around as the others did. He grew so excited that when at last he did stop to look for the fairy, she had gone. He was a real rabbit at last, at home with the other rabbits. Ah, there's a little bit more left to the story, but let me do a good girl for Afghanistan. Good girl. Good, good girl. You're such a sweet, sweet, good girl. So cute. So adorable. So beautiful and kind. Good, good girl. You need to remember that you're loved and enjoyed by all. And that asleep, sweetheart. It's so late, and you need to close those cute little eyes. I'll give you a kiss on your forehead. And you can drift right off to sleep. I'll tuck you in a blankie. You can close those heavy, heavy eyes of yours and fall right to sleep, my beautiful darling girl. And I'll do your scissors, sweet veggie, after I read a little bit more of the story. Thank you, sweet Gabs. An odd thing about reading is it actually takes a lot out of your voice in comparison to ASMR, but back to reading some more I go. Autumn passed, and winter, and into spring, when the days grew warm and sunny, the boy went out to play in the wood behind the house, and while he was playing, two rabbits crept out from the bracken and peeped at him. One of them was brown all over, but the other had strange markings under his fur, as though long ago he had been spotted, and his spots were still showing through, and about his soft nose and his little black eyes there was something familiar, so that the boy thought to himself, why, he looks just like my old bunny that was lost when I had scarlet fever. But he never knew that really was his old bunny. Come back to look at the child who had first helped him to be real. And that was the Velveteen Rabbit. I hope you enjoyed that story, sweetheart. I still have a little more for you. What would you like to enjoy? I have a little Red Riding Hood. That one is always cozy. Snow White. I never actually read that one, I think. Let me go sip some more water, sweetheart. Say to Snow White, oh, you want it, sweetheart? Perfect. This one probably will be a long one, so let's get ready. Snow White. There was once a queen who had no children, and it grieved her sorely. One winter's afternoon, she was sitting by the window sewing, when she pricked her finger, and three drops of blood fell on the snow. Then she thought to herself, ah, what would I give to have a daughter of skin as white as snow, and cheeks as red as blood? After a little while, and the little daughter came to her with skin as white as snow and cheeks as red as blood, so that they called her Snow White. But before Snow White had grown up, her mother, the queen, died, and her father married again, the most beautiful princess, who was very vain of her beauty and jealous of all women who might be as fond as beautiful as she was. And every morning, she used to stand in front of your mirror and say, mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of us all? And a mirror always used to reply, "Queen, queen, on thy throne, the greatest beauty is thine own." But Snow White grew fairer and fairer every year, till at last one day when the queen in the morning spoke to her mirror and said, "Mirror, mirror, on the wall, who is the fairest of us all?" The mirror replied, "Queen, queen, on thy throne, Snow White, the fairest thou must own." Oh my, oh my. That's going to certainly cause drama, isn't it? Now let me go do the nice, cozy scissors redeem. Because I know Sweetheart Veggie and Sweetheart Gabs enjoy it. Thank you, sweet veggie. I always like these scissors because they made a great cozy noise. Mark's knife edge, chrome-plated scissors, made in Brazil. I know a cutie from Brazil. He is amazing, I love him greatly. Oh, sorry about that little click. Scissor time before I get back to reading. I'll probably do it until... It would be a cozy time. 45? Yeah. A few more seconds to make sure that you all don't fall to the eepy sleepy before I finish Snow White. Still have yet to get out that bronze bowl I found, but that's okay, sweeties. I'm sure we can still enjoy it all. Now, back to the story. Then the queen grew terribly jealous of Snow White, and thought how she could get rid of her, till at last she went to a hunter, and engaged him for a large sum of money to take Snow White out in the forest, and kill her, and bring her heart back to her. But when the hunter had taken Snow White out into the forest, and thought to kill her, she was so beautiful that his heart failed him, and he let her go, telling her she must not, for his sake, and for her own, return to the king's palace. For he had killed a deer and brought back the heart to the queen, telling her that was the heart of Snow White. Snow White wandered on and on till she got through the forest, and came to a mountain hut, and knocked at the door, but she had got no reply. She was so tired that she lifted up the latch and walked in, and there she had saw three little beds, and three little chairs, and three little cupboards, all ready for use. she would empty the first bed and lay down upon it. But it was so hard that she couldn't rest. Then she went to the second bed and lay down upon that. But it was so soft that she had got too hot and couldn't go to sleep. So she tried the third bed, but that was neither too hard nor too soft. But it suited her exactly, and she fell asleep there. In the evening, the owners of the hut, who were three little dwarves who had earned their living by digging coal in the hills, came back to their home, and when they came in, they had washed themselves, and they had went to their beds, and for the first time said, "Somebody has been sleeping in my bed." Then the second one said, "And somebody has been sleeping in my bed." And the third one called out in a shrill voice, for he was so excited, "Somebody is sleeping in my bed. Just look at how beautiful she is." So they waited till she woke up and asked her how she had come there. She told them all that the hunter had said to her about the queen wanting to slay her. Then the dwarves asked her if she'd be willing to stop with them and keep house for them. And she had said that she'd be delighted. Next morning, the queen went up as usual to her mirror and called out, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of them all?" "Ah, Snow White, the fairer." And the mirror answered as usual, "Queen, queen on thy throne, Snow White's the fairest thou must own." And the queen knew that Snow White had not been slain, so that she sent for the hunter and made him confess that he had let Snow White go, and that she had made him search about beyond the forest, till at last he had brought back word that to her that Snow White was dwelling in a little hut on a hill with some coal miners. Then the queen dressed herself up like an old woman, and taking a poison comb to her, went back the next day to the hut where Snow White was living. Then the dwarves had warned her not to open the door to anyone, lest evil befall her, and she found it very lonesome, keeping always within doors. When the queen, disguised as an old woman, came to the door of the house, she knocked upon it with her stick. But Snow White called out from within, "Who is it? Go away. I must not let anyone or anybody in." "All right," answered the queen, "but if you come to the window, we can have a little chat here, and I can show you my wares." So then Snow White came to the window. The queen said, "Oh, what beautiful black hair. You ought to have a comb to bind it up." She showed her a comb that she had brought with her. But Snow White said, "I have no money, and I cannot afford to buy so fine a comb." Then the queen said, "That is no matter. Perhaps you have something golden you can give me in exchange." And Snow White thought of a golden ring that her father had given to her, and offered to give it for the comb. The queen took it and gave Snow White the comb and bade her goodbye, and went back to the palace. Snow White lost no time in going to the mirror and binding up her hair and putting the comb into it, but had scarcely bent her hair for a few minutes when she had fell down as if she were dead, and all the blood left her cheeks, and she was Snow White indeed. When the dwarves came home that evening, they were surprised to find the table not spread for them, and looking about, they had soon found Snow White lying upon the ground, as if she were dead. But one of them listened to her heart, and said, "She lives, she lives." And they began to consider what caused Snow White to fall in such a swoon. They had soon found the comb, when they took it out, Snow White had opened her eyes and become as lively as she ever was before. My, my. How darling indeed. The next morning, the queen went to the mirror in the wall and said to it, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of them all?" The mirror said as before, "Queen, queen, on thy throne, Snow White's the fairest thou must own." Then the queen knew that something happened to the comb and that Snow White was still alive, so that she dressed herself once more as the old woman and took with her a poisoned ribbon and went to the hut of the three dwarves. And when she got there, she knocked at the door, but Snow White called out, "You cannot enter, I must not open the door." Then, as before, the queen called out in reply, "Then come to the window, you can see my wares." Then Snow White came to the window, and the queen said, "You are looking more beautiful than ever, but how becoming for you to arrange your hair. Did you use the comb I gave you yesterday?" "Yes, indeed," said Snow White, "and I fell into a swoon because of it. I am afraid there is something the matter with it." "No, no, there cannot be. There must be some mistake. But I cannot use... If you cannot use the comb, I'll let you have this pretty ribbon instead." And she held out the poisoned ribbon. Snow White took it, and after the old woman, as she said, as she thought she was, had gone away, Snow White went to the mirror and tied up her hair with a piece of ribbon, but scarcely had she done so when she fell to the ground lifeless and lay there as if she were dead. That evening they came home and found Snow White lying on the ground as if dead, and soon discovered the poisoned ribbon and untied it. And almost as soon as this was done, Snow White was revived again. Next morning, the queen went once more to the mirror on the wall and called out, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of us all?" To which the mirror replied, without any change, "Queen, queen, on thy throne, Snow White's the fairest thou must own." And the queen recognized that once again her plans have failed, and Snow White was still alive. So she dressed herself once more and took her poisoned apple, which was so arranged that only one half of it was poisoned, and the rest of it was left as before. And then the queen got to the hut of the dwarf. She tried to open the door, but Snow White called out, "You cannot come in." "Then I'll come in the window." "Ah, you were the old lady that came twice before. You have not brought me good luck. Each time something has befallen me." But the queen said, "I do not know how that can be. I only brought you something for your hair. Perhaps you tied it too tight. I'll show you, and I have no ill will against you. I have brought to you this beautiful apple." "But my guardian," said Snow White, "told me that I must take nothing more from you." "Oh, this is nothing to wear," said the queen. "This is something to eat. I'll show you that there can be no harm in it. I will take half of it myself, and you shall eat the other half." So she cut the apple in two and gave the poisoned half to Snow White. Then, the moment she swallowed the first bite, she fell down dead. Then the queen slunk away and went back to the palace, and went at once to her chamber, addressed the mirror on the wall, and said, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of us all?" The queen answered, as it used to, "Queen, queen, on thy throne, the greatest beauty is thine own." Then the queen knew that Snow White was dead at last, and that she was without a rival in beauty. When the dwarves came home that night, they found Snow White lying upon the ground, quite dead. They could not find out what happened or how they could cure her, but she seemed quite dead. Snow White had kept her beautiful white skin and seemed more like a statue than a dead person. So the dwarves had built her a glass coffer made, but put Snow White in and locked it up. She remained there for days and days without changing in the slightest, looking oh so beautiful under the glass case. Now a great prince of the neighboring country happened to be on a hunting near the hill of the dwarves and called at their little hut to get a glass of water. And when he came in, he found nobody but Snow White lying in her glass coffer. And when he fell at once in love with her and sat by her side, the dwarves came home, and he asked them who she was. And then they told her, they told him her history, and he begged that he may carry the coffer away, so that he may always have her near him. And at first they would not, but he showed them how much he loved her, so that they at last yielded, and he called for his men to carry the coffer home to his palace. And when the men commenced carrying the coffer down the mountain, they jolted so much that a piece of the poison apple in Snow White's throat fell out, and she revived, opened her eyes, and looked upon the prince who was riding by her side. When he had ordered the coffer to be opened, he told her all that had happened, and he took her home to his castle and married her. After this happened, the queen once more came to her room, spoke to the mirror on the wall, and said, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest of us all?" Was the fairest of us all. And this time the mirror said again, "Queen, queen on thy throne, Snow White's fairest thou must own." And the queen was so enraged because she had not destroyed Snow White that she rushed to the window and threw herself out of it and died on the spot. The end. Now, sweeties, it's normal time for redeems. I hope Darling Bay is doing the Yippee Sleepy, and that you, Nancy Sweetheart, have rested well and cozy. Roxy wants a good kitten. Okay. Roxy, my sweetest, goodest kitty. You're so warm, so beautiful, so fluffy and soft. I really do think you're amazing for being here every time. Thank you for being so cozy, sweeties. Also, if anyone has any redeems they want done, please do them all. And thank you for the head pats, Crunchy. I hope you enjoyed that while you're playing games. And are you playing Minecraft right now by chance? I'd love to join you for a little bit if you are. And Gabs, you good, sweet puppy girl. You are such an amazing person. So adorable with your beady eyes. So soft, pet. I hope you're enjoying your nice little puppy bed right now, listening to me just read stories. and teal, my little bird, my sweetest, cutest little bird. Good birdie, good, good birdie. Now, I'm going to do something covertly. You hear no clicks or clacks at all right now. Nope. I truthfully have no one I want to go and share you with right now. Well then, I suppose that's it for tonight. My sweet, beautiful darlings. Remember that I do love you all. I'll do some more little misty things for you, because I know you love it all so dearly. And yet again, my most enjoyed streams are me reading. I do love you all so much. You're all so sweet. You actually make me happy, too. I notice whenever I stream, my seasonal depression is at its least, and I don't really have any negative thoughts. So, I thank you all for being in my life, sweethearts. I really do. Thank you, Teal. It's always good to hear. You're sufficiently missed, and good night, darling Teal. Good night, sweet Nancy. Good night, Gabs. Good night, Veggie. Good night, Bay. Good night. Oh my, oh my. I think everyone was relaxing too much. Good night, Winter. Good night, Tori. Good night, Twisted. Good night, Mackie. Good night, Lizzie. Good night, man of massive bladder. Good night. Good night, Arakuri. Good night, Dirona. Good night, my beautiful darlings. Remember that I love and enjoy you all, and that you're all beautiful and amazing. And I truly do so very much love you all. Thank you for being in my life. And have a good morning, Bread. I'm ending now, but that's okay. I love you greatly. And thank you, Aiden. May you have a good, cozy night. And, was Fanta streaming earlier? I sent them some cat pictures because I was too shy to message him, but I hope if they had a stream that is nice and cozy. Also, why, sweethearts, why are you coming in when I'm about to end? I suppose it's okay, though. Anyway, good night, darlings. I love you all. You never slept, Bolt. Schlaf gut, meine gute Bolt. Love you all, and hopefully I can play just a little bit of what is it? Minecraft with sweet, sweet Crunchy. Perhaps Trey if you want to as well. But it's only your choice. And thank you for the follow, Bending Silver Spoons. If you would like a follow or a free redeem, just ask. All you have to do is just use your patience, find one you like, and enjoy it. Here, if you want to see more of me and all the nice, cozy things I do, for more reading streams like this, or even just me being me and my great weirdness, it's all okay. But good night, darlings. I love you all. I'll give you a little purr before I end, and I'll go take a sip too, sweetie. Good night now, darlings. I love you all.